You may start presenting once the recording has started. Yeah, you may start now.
Okay, so good morning everyone. We are here to give a small seminar on a project which we carried out using virtual instrumentation. It's a virtual digital storage oscilloscope. So to begin with, let's talk about oscilloscopes first. They are one of the most widely used instruments for signal measurement and analysis. So if you want to measure any electrical signal, or if you basically want to do any kind of electronic project or core electrical project, then you will have to get yourself acquainted with this instrument. It is very useful, and you can basically analyze various parameters of the signals that you are working with. It can be electrical signals or communication signals flowing through electrical channels, of course. So let me tell something about the types of oscilloscopes. So the first and foremost type was that was very designed very earlier, was the cathode ray oscilloscope. It used a cathode ray tube, and that's why it's called so. So it used the cathode ray tube to actually display like project an electron beam on a fluorescent screen to actually display the waveform that it is getting. But as the design was as I said, the design was very old, and now the technological advancements have been made. So basically cathode ray oscilloscope only had the ability to show the waveform on the screen with basic functionality such as triggering, but it couldn't readily analyze the signals, meaning that for example, if you see any digital storage oscilloscope, you will have analysis features for signals such as the rise time, peak time, and all the transient as well as steady state analysis, but those were missing. Then there was a dual beam oscilloscope, which was just an advancement for the CRO. It consisted its cathode ray tube basically consisted of two deflectors, so that two signals would be visible at a time on the display. But more. Then there were analog storage oscilloscopes.
Four sections are there. In the section, let's hear you.
In analog storage oscilloscopes, there are two basic features, like the two basic ways to store the. Ma'am, there are disturbances from your microphone, I guess. It's switching on and off in between. So yeah, analog storage oscilloscope. As I said, cathode ray oscilloscope or dual beam oscilloscope, which was just a small advancement for the CRO, didn't have the functionality to store the waveform. They could just show the waveform as long as the input was provided into the channels. So analog storage oscilloscope, basically there were two types of it, which you one was electrostatic storage and the other one was fluorescent storage. They were used to store the signals on the display. There was no digital storage or something like that. So basically in electrostatic storage type, there was, as I said, the cathode ray tube. So the electrostatic charge for the cathode ray tube was maintained even after the signal was removed, so that the waveform stayed on the screen or on the display, not the screen exactly.
Tanmay, you're mute. Your voice is not audible. Could others hear him?
No, ma'am.
Check.
It was basically a groundbreaking design for oscilloscopes.
Tanmay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, for maybe 30 seconds or so, your voice was not audible.
Okay, I
So
think
could
I
you
got
repeat what you
disconnected.
had? Yeah, so you
Sure, ma'am.
ensure that in, yeah.
So I believe I was talking about analog storage oscilloscopes. In analog storage oscilloscopes, there are two types: electrostatic storage and fluorescent storage. In electrostatic storage type, the signal that is given to this oscilloscope is replicated, and electrostatic charge similar, like mimicking that signal, is given to the cathode ray tube even after the signal is removed, so that the waveform is maintained on the display. And in the fluorescent type, the display is itself fluorescent, so that the electron beam actually energizes or creates a fluorescence on the display even after the signal is removed. So that was not really a digital type of storage or memory, but it was just a way to maintain the signal on the display even after the actual signal was removed, so that the person who is analyzing the signals could take his time to actually measure the values. Then this digital storage oscilloscope was a very good advancement towards signal measurement analysis, because it gave the features of signal analysis online, as well as storage, which is a very important part for post analysis of the signals. I will talk about this DSOs as we go further, because we have implemented a virtual DSO itself. Now, lastly, mixed signal oscilloscopes. So right down bottom right, you have an image of a mixed signal oscilloscope by Keysight. So basically, the key difference between digital storage oscilloscope and mixed signal oscilloscope is that both in DSO and MSO, you can view both analog and digital signals. But in MSO, you have the functionality to actually temporally correlate those signals, as you can see in this image. So here you can see an analog waveform, and here you can see a range, like 8 digital waveforms, but they are also temporally correlated, as in this time steps are actually matching with respect to each signal. In DSOs, you cannot achieve this temporal correlation. Both you can view both the signals, but they need not be like visualized as the like with respect to the same time reference. So now let's talk about why we should go for virtual instrumentation. So like the instruments that I discussed earlier, or the ones which are available in hardware form, as we can say, are called conventional instruments, and they are very bulky, as you might have seen in our labs also. The oscilloscopes are pretty big, and they have very high costs. Of course, a part of it is because of the branding and the companies selling them, but of course they require a lot of hardware resources to build them, including like sophisticated signal processing hardware and other things like display and everything. Another limiting factor for them is the upgrading features. So of course, any company would have limited number of features in one particular instrument, and even if they were to upgrade it, they wouldn't necessarily upgrade the same design. They would actually come up with a different product and would sell it up like separately. So basically, once you buy an oscilloscope or any conventional instrument for that matter, the features that it has are limited. For as long as you retain that instrument, you don't go and buy another one which has advanced features. And also, being hardware instruments, they require a lot of maintenance. Of course, like some of the manufacturers take care of this by offering warranties and all, but yeah, they actually at the very base, they do require maintenance. Now, coming to virtual instruments, they are virtual, meaning they are mostly software applications which have a driver application to actually interact with minimal hardware interfacing unit. So this actually covers up for almost all of the above mentioned drawbacks for conventional instruments. Like, it is not bulky, since you have minimal hardware involved. The cost is not, again, I cannot really directly comment on the cost, because of course, if they are proprietary softwares, then companies might sell them at high costs. But to be really honest, the cost is not as high as compared to, or shouldn't be as high as compared to the hardware instruments. Upgrades actually you, for being virtual or being software products, they can be upgraded as and when like the upgrades are available or any new functionality is available, and the developers can just reprogram the virtual instrument and release the update. And again, the maintenance is not really required because it's a software. Of course, security features and all that kind of if it's an online version or something, then that care should be taken, but it doesn't require hardware maintenance is what I'm saying. And the last point is like it is very much only applicable to virtual instruments. Like for example, if you like we are going to talk about virtual DSOs, but in general, there can be n number of virtual instruments and they can be installed on the same device or same PC. Rather than actually carrying different actual conventional instruments with you. For example, for signal analysis, basic analysis can be done with a multimeter itself, but for advanced analysis, you can go for a oscilloscope. So if you want to actually carry out a project in field, for example, so you need not carry both a virtual multimeter and a oscilloscope with you. You just can carry a hardware interfacing unit, which is small. I'll just show the showing the demo. I'll most probably be able to convince you how small it is. So, and you can just carry your own laptop with you, which you will be anyway carrying, and you can just get done with it. And you can have both the virtual instruments for multimeter and oscilloscope installed on the same laptop. So it will be very convenient. So this is particular for the R project. This is the system architecture that we have developed. So here we have this is the hardware interfacing unit part, and this is the virtual instrument part. I'll be going in depth more in detail. So basically, as you can see, we have 8 different channels that are fed to the 10-bit ADC module, and then from the ADC module they are fed to the serial port to transfer the data to the computer, which is running the virtual instrument application software. Now, when we enter this virtual instrument, basically we have several different things. First of all, we just instantaneously view the input signal on the waveform chart. And then we have other functionalities such as we have a graph palette to zoom and pan and just see the waveform with the convenience while the VI is running. And then we have a voltage and time division control, which will basically enable us to select the range and difference between the intermediate time and voltage steps. Then we have a functionality to save the data as an image or export it to a file. And we have also a file format and a location selection, which will enable us to conveniently store it on our personal computer. And then to enable this entire instrument, we have several controls such as the power, pause, and channel selection. So the power is the control that will actually enable or disable this entire virtual instrument. And pause control is given for the user to actually instantaneously pause or freeze this waveform and data recording facility. And what this actually does is, even though the input signal is coming, it will not actually update the waveform chart. We will giving a small demo of this in the upcoming time. Ma'am, did I get disconnected in between or is it fine?
No, you can continue.
Yeah, so the final control that we have here is the channel selection. Now, as I said, there are 8 different channel inputs to this oscilloscope. And we can conveniently select any particular channel that we want to view the data from. So this is the virtual instrument of the entire project. So this is just the front panel of it, and we will be describing about the block diagram shortly. So in the front panel, there are several components that are described here. So the first one here is the graph palette, which is used to move the cursors, zoom and pan the graph, which basically means this is the graph window. You can add cursors for measurement, and you can just zoom. For example, you want to see this particular part of the waveform closely, so you can zoom on that particular part, or you can zoom on the entire waveform to analyze it more precisely. The second component here is the indicator LED, which is present for each and every channel, as you can see. And since the first channel is selected and we are viewing the waveform from that particular channel, the LED indicator for that particular channel is energized to indicate that that particular channel is being read at the particular moment. The third element is the channel readout display, which actually displays the instantaneous voltage reading for that particular channel. So for example, you could see 4.6 volts for this channel as the instantaneous reading. And if you see, this is the most updated time frame for this waveform. So if you just see, it is the 4.6 magnitude in terms of voltage. And all other channels are indicating -1, which we will talk about shortly. Why is it so? The fourth element is the waveform chart display itself. That is this particular window that I was talking about. So it will show the instantaneous value of the signal, as well as some history buffer of it. The fifth element is the serial port select switch. So it is basically a drop-down menu, as we might have seen several times. And it basically lets you select the communication port for the hardware interfacing unit. And the sixth element is the power button. So this is a control that I was talking about. It is facilitated so as to disable or enable the functionality of this entire oscilloscope. Meaning, if this is energized, then only this entire instrument will work, otherwise it won't. Seventh element is the pause button. So this pause button also, as I talked about in the previous slide, is given so as to instantaneously freeze the display and the data recording facility that we have given here. The eighth element is the record time. Now, when someone wants to export the waveform data to a file, he can just click the format, select the format from here below and export it to a file. And this particular indicator will show how much time has elapsed since the data has been recorded. So for example, if a user wants to, say, record a data for 100 seconds, he can conveniently see whether that much amount of data is recorded or not. The ninth element is the export to file function, which basically, as I said, gives a control to start writing to a file. And here we have a radio control to select which type of file we really want to export. The 10th is similar for, 10th element is similar setup for exporting as an image. So we can select the format and we can save the instantaneous image of the waveform display. And 11th element is the voltage division control, and 12th one is the time division control that I was speaking. So here you can see 0.1 seconds, 0.2 seconds. So these are basically the amount of increments that we can expect on the time division, that is the horizontal axis, and voltage division is for the vertical axis. So here we can see that the voltage division is currently set to 1 volt, meaning the difference between each of these values is 1 volt. So we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 volts. So let me talk about the hardware interfacing unit. If you guys have seen Arduino Nano, you would like be able to like make sense of how small this unit is actually. So yeah, we are using Arduino Nano, which has ATmega328P microcontroller. It is an 8-bit AVR RISC architecture with 32 KB memory, flash memory. So that's why its name is 328. And it has a low power, it runs in a low power mode. So that's why that P. So just to clarify the naming convention, it has a 16 megahertz clock frequency. Now all the other parameters, like all the other specifications of the microcontroller, I have just omitted because you can find it easily on any like when you refer the data sheet. But these three next points are like pertaining to specifics of an design of a oscilloscope. So I will be talking about them now. So it has a 16 megahertz clock frequency. Now, clock frequency is important because when you are analyzing a signal, your processor's clock frequency should be much more than the signal that is incoming, so that it can actually process the data within adequate time. Next, we have a 10-bit ADC inbuilt in this microcontroller. Now, there are two versions of this, or two packages available for this microcontroller. One is a dual inline package and the other one is thin quad flat package. So in dual inline package, for I don't know whether it's for proprietary reasons or whether it's design constraints, they have limited the channels to 6. But in thin quad flat package, you have 8 channels. And that is one of the prominent reasons why we chose Arduino Nano. One of the reasons was, of course, because it's small. And the second one, or most important here, is that you can see here, it uses a thin quad flat package of the microcontroller, which has 8 channels. And that's why we also can provide 8 different channels for our oscilloscope. The effective sampling rate calculation here, as I said, the clock frequency of this microcontroller is 16 megahertz. But the time it takes to sample an ADC is 128 clock cycles. So effectively, we are left with only 125 kilohertz. And again, ADC itself takes 13 clock cycles to actually acquire the signal and convert it into digital form. So if we divide this value again by 13, we get somewhat about 10 kilohertz maximum upper limit of the frequency. So according to Nyquist criteria, we should limit ourselves to like maximum 5 kilohertz of the signal frequency. And if you really want to get a good resolution, it should be 1/10 of or less than this. So basically 1 kilohertz or less. So this is one of the limiting factors of our hardware instrument, since we are using a pretty low cost microcontroller, which has limited features. But this can be addressed by going for a more sophisticated data acquisition system. So here I have a picture of what we did in the sensors and actuators lab at our department. So here we have the DSO from the lab, and it is generating a signal, a sine wave currently, and we are feeding it back to the same channel one, so as to visualize it on this DSO. So the signal is being generated and feeding back to the channel of the DSO to just visualize it. And here we have a hardware instrument, hardware interfacing unit of our virtual DSO. So you can see that the connection is being tapped for the signal to go to channel number one, and we have connected it to the laptop. So, and the laptop is running the virtual instrument application. So we can visualize the signal. It's you can see that the core from correlation that they are the same thing. So now let me show the block diagram and working demo. So here is the block diagram of the entire virtual instrument. So let me start from the outermost thing. Here we have a while loop, which is like encompassing all of the other blocks. This is actually not really required if you want to run it from within the LabVIEW software itself, since you have a continuous run button here. But since we had planned to export it as a standalone executable file, so actually we require this while loop to run it continuously. Inside this while loop, you have a power button, and you have a local. We have created a local variable to actually keep track of that power button status. So in the next part is a case structure in which we have two different cases. The first case is just this is a sequence structure, and in this sequence structure we have two different sequences. The first sequence is just a while loop, so until the power button is pressed, it will stay in this sequence. Once the power button is pressed, it will move to the next sequence, which is this part. So here we have a communication port block and serial communications initialization block. So basically, this communication port, as Chinmay said, will enable the user to actually select the hardware interfacing port, which the instrument, the hardware interfacing unit is currently connected to. And then this block will initialize the serial communication. So once the communication is initialized, there will be two channels. One is the data channel, and the other one is error channel for debugging purposes. So once the data arrives, then we go into this while loop, wherein I'll just go from top just so that we don't miss anything. So here, as explained by Chinmay, we have a time division control and a voltage division control. These are two knob controls and they go to different case structures. So basically we have five different discrete cases for each of these. So if you see the front panel of the virtual instrument, you can see that there are five discrete cases, and for each case we have just computed the scale required magnification, and just we give it as the output to the property of the oscilloscope, which is just the waveform chart. Then here, this is just done to reset the virtual instrument if the power button is switched off. So here, as I said, you have a local variable and we are just using an instance of that variable to check whether if it's true or false. So if it's true means power is on, power button is on. So in that case, you don't have to do anything. But if the power button is switched off, the history buffer is cleared by passing zero values to everything so that the waveform chart is also cleared. Down here, we have the channel control for all the eight channels. So again, we have the instance of the local variable of the power button to ensure that the power is still on. And while the power is on, we have an AND case that while the power is on, we have to check whether the channel control is switched on. So front panel, you have a channel control for each of the different channels, Boolean control. So if it's switched on, that means
later on you break.
So if the channel control is on, that means you have requested the VI to actually visualize the signal. As again Chinmay said, and just to clear it up, the signal acquisition is continuously going on, but if it's your or the user's choice to actually visualize it on the screen, so that's for that purpose we have defined these buttons to actually control the, because if you don't really have eight different channels, there might be noise present in other channels, or even if you have eight signals coming in, chances are that the waveform will look very cluttered. So to avoid that, you can conveniently select between any of the channels you want. So that's about this control, and it's directly given to each indicator to specify whether that particular channel is on. So here you have ADD indicators indicating which channel is on currently. And once with that Boolean control, you have case structures for each of the channels. So if the channel is switched on, then the data coming into this channel, the ping channel, is taken into the case structure. If it's false, you can see that a constant value of -1 is returned. So if it's true, then this is just to demultiplex the first wire of this channel, and the particular data is then transmitted out of this case structure to the further display and analysis. So that's about the first channel, and similarly for all the eight channels, there are the same case structures for whether to see whether the channel is switched on or off.
The only difference in that is here you can see 0, here you can see 1, here you can see 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So these numbers indicate which wire of this particular channel to select. So for example, in case of hardware, you might imagine that this is a bus which has 8 different wires, and basically each of these channels, what they are doing is they are displaying the data for that for a particular wire in that bus.
So now coming to the next part. So all these data that is coming from each of the channel is then concatenated into a cluster and bundled into a cluster, to be more specific about the terminology. And if the pause button is not pressed, like this is the false condition, if the pause button is not pressed, then all this data is continuously sent to the waveform chart for display. And here we have to, this is the functionality for writing the data to the file. So basically we just convert this into an array, and this array is then converted into dynamic data type, which is used by the Express VI instrument here. So that data is then given as a signal to this Express VI. This is just Express VI to write a measurement file. Then as I said, in the front, while describing the VI front panel, this is the radio buttons for selecting the type of file. So here you have three different file: Excel, text, or LabVIEW measurement file, and the binary file. So based on that, again, when saving, you will get more options in it. So once the file type is selected and you hit the record button, the Express VI will start a secondary timer. Okay, now let me clear this. There is a primary timer going on while for the entire while loop for running the or like acquiring the signal and displaying it and everything. And inside the file write function, you have a secondary timer which actually compares itself with the primary timer, and the difference is shown as the record time. So that gives the user an idea of how much time it has elapsed since the recording was started. And that is about the file writing, this particular case structure. If you see that if the condition is false, then nothing will be written. And here, if the condition is false, like the pause button is, sorry, here, if the condition is true, that means the pause button is pressed, nothing will be updated, everything will be frozen. So coming to the save image, so you have a similar save image button in the front panel. So here you have a save image button and you have to select the file data type or image type you want to save. And based on that, here we are not using an Express VI, we are just using the low level file writing block of per each type of image.
We lost the audio.
Tanmay? Yeah, I think you're not audible.
So, and
Tanmay, Tanmay?
Yes, ma'am.
You were not audible for from some 20 seconds at least.
Okay. So. Yeah. Did I explain about the export file part? Did you hear about the export file?
No, no.
Nope, you are talking about the image.
You were about image files.
Before that, I talked about the export file, right?
Yeah, yeah, that is done. You have to discuss about saving the images.
Okay. So, when saving the images, again, as discussed in the front panel, so here you have an option to save the images into different file formats. So once the image file format is selected and you click the save image button, the waveform chart has an inherent property that stores the instantaneous image data. So here we are not using any Express VI like we were using here in case of data writing, because that's a tedious process. But here we are just using the low level block for directly writing the image to a file. So here you have a case select switch for different types of images. So here is for PNG, here is for bitmap, and it's for JPEG. So based on this type of selection, the case will be selected and the image data will be stored in that particular file format. And here down here, now coming, we have this pink channel that was a data channel. So after subsequent sampling for each different channel, we are again getting the stream of the data. So we are using this block to end the communication once the while loop has ended. This just ensures stable stability, because if you leave a connection open, then chances are that the system might not reconnect to the same port after you rerun the VI, or in worst case, the system might get hanged or something like that. Then when we will be disabling this particular while loop, or when we'll be exiting this particular while loop, is based on two conditions. So as I said, here we have a an error channel for debugging purposes, and we can also use the same error signal as a boolean to or it with the power button also. So if the power button is switched off, then or we have an error, we just exit this while loop. Down here we just have a timer. This is the time delay element which we will be using to add a 1 millisecond delay. And this is just also again to ensure that the system is stable. If you don't give this element, the the PC that you are running this VI or application software will try to like acquire the signals and process and do every like every operation explained here at its maximum capacity, which can be good if you want it to, but it is not really recommended since the system can overload itself, and again, as I said, it might hang or give some weird results. So this is ensuring this for the stability purpose. And once we exit this while loop, as I said, the connection for the serial port is closed. And after that, you just exit out of this sequence structure. And the last while loop, as I said, is only meant for running this VI continuously. So in the lab view, you have this continuous run functionality, but we have exported it as a standalone application where you don't have it. So that's why we are just continuously keeping it false so that it runs continuously always. So I think that was all of it. Yeah, so that was about the block diagram. Now, coming to the live demonstration. So here we have hooked up the both the this is and on the right you can see what we have designed is signal generator basically. So in the lab we had the virtual DSO the actual oscilloscope by Keysight to actually generate the waveforms, but since all of us are at home and we don't have access to labs, so what we did is for this demonstration purpose, we just designed this particular waveform generator yesterday or day before yesterday. So to generate the any arbitrary waveform that we can. So basically we have different programs for DC signal, for triangular wave, sawtooth, square signal, sinusoidal signal, and everything. And we just have to reprogram this Arduino to generate that particular signal. Today we'll be demonstrating the sine wave. So here you have a 12-bit DAC module, which takes the values from the channel of this. It uses basically I2C communication to communicate with this microcontroller. And when the microcontroller writes data to it, it converts it into analog form and then it gives it as an output. On the left side, you have the hardware interfacing unit for the virtual DSO that we have designed. And this also uses the same microcontroller and it has 8 channels. I don't know if they are visible here, but if you see this particular image, you can see clearly that there are 8 different channels over here. One is the ground rail and the outer one is the ground rail and the inner one are the 8 different channels. So here you can have a better view. So like all the eight channels have the wires connected to them. So that's this. And here we have just given a common grounding, which is the black wire. And the white wire is the signal, which is coming out from the DAC. And we are just giving it to the first channel. So here is the standalone application. As you can see, I am not running the instrument from the lab view because it is unnecessary to, it has to process more background checks in the lab view when it's running in the lab view environment than when we run it exclusively standalone, because here you don't have to worry about lab view background processes. So it is much more efficient when we run it this way. So I'll select the communication port as COM3, which is the port that this oscilloscope is connected to. And I'll just set the time scales for maximum and the voltage division to maximum, since we are going to simulate or we are going to acquire a signal for a sine wave with 1 hertz frequency. So that's why we don't need much smaller time division. And the voltage is set to 1 volt, since we'll be acquiring a sine wave of five volt amplitude with 2.5 volt offset. So it will be occupying the entire waveform area. So let me just switch on the first channel and power on. So once the once the communication is established, yeah, here you can see the channel LED glowing and you can see the waveform that is being acquired. So this is all happening in real time. The DAC, this particular microcontroller has been programmed. We basically started with MATLAB. We generated a sine wave in MATLAB and exported the data, discrete time data, as a lookup table. And we took that lookup table and program this microcontroller to save it as a constant in its memory, and wrote a for loop to actually iteratively go through each and every element at a defined time step, and based on that it will basically generate a discrete time sine wave. It will be then communicated using I2C to this DAC module, which will continue convert it into analog signal, and it will pass on to this virtual DSO hardware interfacing unit. The microcontroller on this hardware interfacing unit has an ADC, 10-bit ADC, as I talked about earlier. It will convert that analog signal into digital form, and it will communicate that through a serial COM port to this virtual instrument. And this virtual instrument then will display it on this graph and have all the additional functionalities. So if I switch this channel off, you can see that the acquisition is no more visualizable, but of course it is happening in the background. If I switch it on, then you can see it from the exact time reference that it was switched on. Similarly, for the pause functionality, if I pause the waveform, you can see that everything is frozen here. You can take measurements or do whatever you want with the signal right now. And once you hit the, again, as I said, the acquisition is not paused, only the visualization is paused. So if you resume it again, it will start to, it will resume from the time instant that it is acquiring the current signal. So that's why you can see a discrepancy over here. This just ensures that the signal acquisition and display are maintained in real time. So it's not fooling you. Or for example, if you have a sine wave which turns suddenly into a sawtooth, then you should be able to visualize it in real time. That is the reason for that. And here we have just indicated all the 8 channels differently in different colors. And actually, if you look closely, we had used the same color wires for better visual aiding, so that the users can distinctly differentiate between the channels. So as I said about the grounding, since the signals have a common grounding, there is noise present in the other channels if I switch it on. So that's why we have given this functionality to switch off the channels. Since there is a common grounding and the particular pins on the microcontroller are currently left floating, you can see that they are decaying with respect to time, but they can pick up the signal noise from the other channels. So if you have a different signal connected to that particular channel, then this won't happen. But since there is no signal connected there, this noise is coming. So that's why we have given the functionality to switch off that particular all the channels that are not required. And that is
here we can see that the instantaneous value of the channel is indicated. So if I pause the display, you can see that currently it is saying 3.55 volts, which is the value that we can see here. And if I resume, you can see that the value is constantly changing. For all other channels, it is left to -1, which is not basically reading from that channel. It is just saying that this channel, particular channel, is turned off. And -1 is just for giving a valid value on the waveform chart. But since we have limited the visual, like the visible portion of this chart from 0 to 5, this value is not actually visible. If you go down in the virtual instrument and you just happen to see the negative range of this chart, then you can actually see that all other channels are giving a value of -1 at this point. But it is not actually a valid voltage value. So you can infer from that these particular channels are not active at the moment.
So you save the particular image. If you want to save the image of this, you can just click the save image, give any name to it, for example. And if you go there, you will have an image saved, which is showing you the instantaneous image captured. Similarly, for the data that is you want to export it to a file, you have to click export file, and it will start exporting in the background. It will start recording. So if I again say export it as a Microsoft Excel sheet, because that is what is selected here. So it's now currently exporting. You can see a lag here because it's exporting into the background, but this is the visualization that's happening. This is not what will be exported. Actually, it will be exporting the accurate values, but since this is loading the computer, it will lag in the display. So once I stop writing, everything will go back to normal in the display part, and we will have an Excel sheet here which will show the timestamped readings of all the 8 channels at a particular time step. And this will go on like for as long as you have recorded the data. So that is about it. I think it gives you a clear idea of the how the virtual instrument is working.
Yeah. So I had this time division that you have given.
Yeah.
It's the time between the vertical grid lines, right?
No, it's the horizontal ones. This is the time axis and this is the voltage axis.
Yeah, the time between the vertical grid lines, that is your time division, right?
Yeah.
But you're given 2 seconds, right? But the vertical grid line, you know, there's like a difference of 40.
In difference of
40.
Why would you want 40 seconds at a time?
No, like look at your
this series you're saying.
Yeah.
These are not seconds. This is the time instant given by what I can say, the discrete time instant given by LabVIEW graph waveform chart. So if you can see, this is not the second value. The second is actually, this is not related to the second. This is related to the clock cycles that the CPU is running on, and it is not really the exact time in seconds, but the like vertical lines that you can see projected on this waveform chart are corresponding to the seconds. So if I've given 2 seconds, that means the major division is 2 seconds.
So we can say in 2 seconds are like 40.
So if I use, if I reduce it to 1 second or say even less, you can see that the fine lines in between those coarse lines that you can see right now are increasing in a number. So here I have a lot more divisions, and as I go reducing them, you can see the difference.
Okay, so each second there are 20 clock cycles happening.
Yeah, you can see that way. So I think you got pretty good understanding of how this virtual instrument works. Now, this is just the experiment we carried out in our lab to confirm the standards of our oscilloscope against the standard of the Keysight DSO that we have in our lab. So I talked about this setup earlier. So let me go to the experiments. So this is the DC waveform or a constant amplitude signal that is given. It has a 2.5 volt offset, meaning it is currently having 2.5 volt offset and a 5 volt amplitude. So it should be ideally giving a 5 volt reading at all times. And here you can see that it is almost getting close to 4.6 or something like that. This is because of the resistance of the probes used, and we'll be discussing more numerical on this later. Similarly, here you have a pulse waveform. I don't know whether you'll be able to visualize this, but there is a small pulse at this time instant and this time instant, which is having a frequency of 1 hertz. So at every second it's happening, and it's having a peak voltage of 5 volts. So it's going from 0 to 5 volts. Similarly, here you can see a pulse picking up at each second, which is similar representation. But here, since the display functionality has additional features such as triggering and waveform reconstruction and waveform, it can resemble the closest waveform it can. So that's why this shows an ideal pulse, which is just a thin line. But here you have the practical pulses, which exist for a certain period of time, and not here. Then this is the square wave. Again, the vertical lines are not really visible because this display has decided to call them as pulses, as I said earlier. But in our DSO, a virtual DSO, you can clearly see the square wave being generated. This is same as the triangular wave. This is pretty much you can see both the waveforms clearly. This is the sawtooth. Again, the vertical lines are not visible because has a property to not show them as waves but impulses, because it's happening at an instant of time. But here you can clearly see the sawtooth waveform. And lastly, the sine waveform. we also saw this demonstration right now, and this was that time it was done using the Keysight DSO. So instead of having this arbitrary waveform generated that we have designed developed yesterday,
we use the arbitrary waveform generator built in to the Keysight DSO that we have in the lab to generate the waveform.
These were the results. So each signal had an amplitude of 5 volt and an offset of 2.5 volt just so that it didn't go in the negative range, and a frequency of 1 hertz. And the Keysight DSO had we just recorded the peak to peak voltage and frequency for each of the signals. So here is the Keysight DSO readings. So for DC, it gave a peak to peak voltage of 80 millivolts, which should be ideally 0 volts since the signal is not varying, but it is a constant value. And in our case, we could observe about 100 millivolt peak to peak voltage difference. This is mostly due to the noise present in the channels, or not, or due to inefficient grounding. Since we are not, we are just common grounding it, not really to any reference, but we are just common grounding it to the circuit. It is not absolute grounding. Then we have a pulse waveform which had a 5 volt amplitude, but here the peak to peak voltage was just seen to be 4.54 volts. In all the cases, the frequency which was set to 1 hertz was observable, and the DSOs could detect it as 1 hertz itself. But the peak to peak voltage had a problem since the signal analysis was either not, it was not a fault on the signal analysis part, but it was rather, as I said, due to the probe resistance, the voltage was dropped actually. So even if it was set to 5 volts, when we were actually getting it on the oscilloscope side, it was for example, for the Keysight DSO, it said that it was getting about 4.54 volts for all the waveforms. But in our case, we were getting a higher value due to the less probe resistance, and it was measuring 4.6 volts. So compared to the absolute input signal, that is these values, we had an error of about 1.3%. Again, it was better than the Keysight DSO itself, which is the industrial standard. You can see it's 4.5 volt and 4.6 volts, but all the other values are pretty much same. But the key limitation in our case was the use of 10-bit ADC for on the microcontroller side, which limited the sampling rate to 10 kilohertz, and hence the signals of, as I said, according to Nyquist limit, we could only analyze up to 5 kilohertz, and to be very efficient in analyzing, we had to keep them well below 1 kilohertz. That's why all the test cases here are of 1 hertz itself. And another limitation was that this being a digital microcontroller can handle only input values between 0 to 5 volts. So anything that is the negative voltage or opposite polarity cannot be detected as such right now. Or any signal that's above 5 volt also cannot be detected as of now. But having added those, for example, for analysis of signals that vary polarity, we can add a rectifier to actually convert it into digital and then into a DC signal, and then we can analyze it. Or for analyzing signals that are above 5 volt, we can add a transformer or a voltage step down converter, and we can just later on amplify it on the VI side to get reconstruct the signal into its original amplitude. That is some of the things that could address these limitations. And again, for the ADC limitation or the sampling rate, we have to go for a sophisticated data acquisition system with a higher resolution ADC and also probably a higher clock frequency microcontroller clock, which supports higher processing speeds. So just to let you know, the Keysight DSO had a sampling rate of 17 megahertz, which is really high as compared to ours, because we use the low-cost microcontroller, but they use industrial standard hardware acquisition data acquisition system. So that's the main key difference. And also we had planned to work on the functional upgrades. So as of now, you could observe a lot of functional features, but there are still more opportunities to add up to this, like triggering or live signal analysis for time domain as well as frequency domain. So all of that was planned, but due to the college work and all the other things, we have just kept the project aside for now. and we'll be working on it as we find time. So thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask.
It was a very good work, Tanmay and Chinmay.
Thank you, ma'am.